Good morning again. Looking at the congregation, there was a moment I saw a load of chairs with coats on them. And if you believe in the rapture theology, I don't, but if you believe in rapture theology, you would have thought that Jesus had just returned. It's either that or people know what I'm going to be teaching on this morning and decided, nah, you're all right, don't listen to that, let's leave. Let's pray, shall we? Lord, maybe after this teaching, some of us wish we were raptured this morning. But Lord, no matter what, whether it be hard teaching or whether it be good teaching, all are good. And Lord, I pray for each of us that we will listen to what you have to say to us in the name of Jesus. Amen. So first and foremost, let me explain to you, I was putting this all together while I was still ill. So if it sounds confused or there's lots of coughs that I come out with, it's written in the script, cough, 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 and cough. If at any point you're confused, just accept that I sneezed a lot as well. Now, I've not spoken for a long time, as in for more than 10 minutes at a time without losing my breath and then coughing a lot. So this is going to be interesting. So turn with me to Mark chapter 10, can you please? Amen. That was the first trumpet in the book of Revelation. Mark chapter 10, starting at verse 1. Now we're going to go through quite a lot of chapter 10 today, very, very quickly, because actually some of it is stuff that we've had before. It's stuff, quite frankly, we know really well. One of it is part of the teaching is actually the young rich ruler, which quite frankly, Bola done such a good job on it a few weeks ago. Just go to the website and look there. But let's start with 1 to 12. So if you remember 2 weeks ago, we left it that the maggot that never dies and needing to give up that maggot to God. And I sort of ended up doing sort of maggot and sin and doing that relation. Who remembers that? Who was here? No, don't remember the maggot that never dies? Okay. Good. It's on the website. It's called the Hungry Maggot, I think, or something like that. Not as cute as the hungry caterpillar. Yeah, it's a good analogy, wasn't it? Yeah, the web author thought it was good. Email me back. Thanks, Andy. But if you look back, there was quite a bit in that. So, here we go. Then Jesus left Capernaum and went down to the region of Judea, into the area east of the Jordan River. Once again, crowds gathered around him, and as usual, he was teaching them. Some Pharisees came and tried to trap him with this question. Should a man be allowed to divorce his wife? Jesus answered them with a question. What did Moses say in the law about divorce? Well, he permitted it, they replied. He said a man could give his wife a written notice of divorce and send her away. But Jesus responded, he wrote this commandment only as a concession to your hard hearts. But God made them male and female from the beginning of creation. This explains why man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. Since they are no longer two, but one, let no one split apart which God has joined together. Later, when he was alone with his disciples in the house, they brought up the subject again. He told them, whoever divorces his wife and marries someone else commits adultery against her. And if a woman divorces her husband and marries someone else, he commits adultery. I make no bones about the fact that this is probably one of those teachings that, quite frankly, if you're honest as a pastor, you really, really don't want to get into on a Sunday morning. There are reasons clearly behind it because, as all churches have people who are divorced and remarried, etc. So you start worrying about being condemned and them having condemnation and all this sort of thing as you go through this passage. So let me put this caveat before everything else. Here is a large broad brush that one uses on a Sunday morning when doing teaching. Yeah? But when you're then dealing with people's individual pastoral situations, you sometimes have to get out a little brush because it's unique to their situation. On a Sunday morning, oh, I would not even begin to be able to cover all bases. At which point you go, thanks for the cop-out. It's not. We'll unpack this, but if you feel at all upset at the end of it all, please do come and see me, okay? That's all I'm going to leave it as. So Jesus has walked out of Capernaum. They've gone on another long journey to Judea there. Basically, now in the book of Mark, they're traveling. Jesus is making his way to Jerusalem for the final time. It's kind of a bit of a dodgy route, but this is what this is. This is the journey. And again, we have Jesus doing some teaching, doing the Lord's work. Doing the right thing. And then the Pharisees arrive, those who believe in a legal framework of life rather than a spirit framework. And they come and ask Jesus a question. I'm going to say Mark points out to us, he's come to do it. They came to do it to try and trap Jesus. To try and catch him out. Now, ever been in a meeting, work, home, and somebody asks a public question to try and catch somebody else out? Ever been in any of those meetings? Yeah. Sorry, you don't have to raise your hand. Why do people do that? It's a real question. It's a real question because I'm meant to have a microphone now. The real question, go Carol.
Because the views that are being put forward are God's views, and so there's a conflict, and they don't like it. So really, they're angry with God because it reveals to them that their thinking isn't right. So they
ask an awkward question.
Got the ump, yeah.
So they get the ump.
Yeah, they ask awkward questions because it doesn't agree with their thoughts and things.
Okay, thank you. There you go. They ask awkward questions because it doesn't agree with their thoughts. They realise their thinking is not right. Yet they still ask the awkward... Ooh. Now, okay, let's take this again, okay? I'm not well. All right? So I do not want to be going back and front, back and front. If you're at the back and you see me, stick your hand in the air.
I think sometimes it's a power play for the person asking the question. It's not actually about what they're even asking necessarily, it's about their power. And
okay, thank you. Power play.
Actually, I was going to say Neil the same as that lady, but I think it's to make people feel small and insignificant at times.
Thank you. Awkward question to make people small and insignificant. Anybody else? It's okay, I'll give you one row's worth.
When people are maybe sometimes are trying to seek an answer for something, maybe they will also ask tough questions because, you know, the answer might be unclear. So, it might also be an honest, tough question.
Yeah, absolutely. An honest, awkward question because they want the answer as well. You're absolutely right. But there is always times and places for that. If you're not sure, and you think, well, how is that going to sound when I ask that question? Maybe I should ask afterwards. But people don't do that. In my old job, it was interesting how people always would ask a question in the most awkward manner, deliberately to cause some sort of suspicion. And here, what we have here is that the Pharisees are really trying to undermine Jesus. They're really trying to find a way to catch him out. And clearly where he was also now at this point was that there was within Antipas and, the name's gone out of my head, I'm trying to do this at the top of my head, were actually in a marriage that in Jewish law shouldn't be happening. She had divorced so she could remarry. And they're actually trying to catch Jesus out. So maybe if he says something that's really untoward, he'll be arrested and removed from power. And most awkward questions in this case is a complete and utter power play. They don't really care. And they probably know what the answer is. But this is a power play. But I love Jesus. He answers back, as always in these times, with another question. So what did Moses say in the law about divorce? Well, he permitted it, they replied. Done that one then. He said a man could give his wife a written notice of divorce and send her away. By the way, please note this. The whole question is based around, can the man divorce his wife? Okay? And that's because supposedly the understanding is at this time is that actually the women couldn't do the divorcing. But that's not strictly true. Within this period of time, the Greeks women did it quite as well. It's written, there's historical records outside of the Bible that women did petition to get divorced from their husbands. So just to play that in here, but just to sort of give you that response. So they quote the Pharisees, Deuteronomy 24. So if you want to, you can turn to it, but hold your finger in Mark. Deuteronomy chapter 24, verses 1 to 4. And it reads, suppose a man marries a woman, but she does not please him. We're going to unpack what that means later. Having discovered something wrong with her, he writes a letter of divorce, hands it to her, and sends her away from his house. When she leaves his house, she is free to marry another man. But if the second husband also turns against her and divorces her, or if he dies, the first husband may not marry her again, for she has been defiled. That would be detestable to the Lord. You must not bring guilt upon the land the Lord your God is giving you as a special possession. Okay. You get a feeling you've got sort of eyes looking at you with a sense of intensity at the moment. This was a concession in Deuteronomy by Moses. Not as such by God, but God allowed it to pass, or else it wouldn't be in the Torah. And actually, this concession, believe it or not, was actually there to protect the women. Wasn't there for the man, because it could look so simple. Oh, God likes the men, doesn't he? He gets them the chances to write a jot of paper, go, here you go, I'll divorce you, get out. Well, where's the protection for the women? That was the protection. Because actually, for a man, if he wants to basically kick his wife out because he doesn't want to know her and get rid of her because she doesn't please him, we'll come to that later. If she's got no written proof at all that she actually is now officially divorced, she can't go and remarry anywhere. She actually needs to have something that proves the fact that she can remarry. She's a free person. Prior to that, it never existed. So she could almost be treated like a servant or a slave, not as a free person. So actually, that concession was there to protect the women. Amen. That's a good thing. It could be so easy to think that God was on the side of the man that he just got to write a note and that's it. But it wasn't. Actually, it was harder because it put shame on the man because there is written evidence and he's got to prove why did he divorce her. And we'll come to that in a moment. So what Jesus is saying here, this ruling that is here was actually there because your hearts are hard, i.e. you're sinful, you're rebellious people, you're clearly not going to follow the rules exactly. Let's live in the real world, shall we? And that's what that's about. So what does Jesus do though? But Jesus doesn't want to go on about it. He actually now says, but hang on a minute. Let's take you back to what scripture says about marriage itself. Why is there marriage? Yeah? So he takes them back to Genesis chapter 1, 27, 5, 2, and 2, 24. And he's saying this is the original and foundation plan of marriage. And if you want me to turn, that's great. Gets used in weddings a lot by me. Like 6 months ago. realise it's been Josh and Nif for 6 months now they've been married. So I'm just going through the contents page. I'll get there in the end. So God created human beings in his own image. He, in the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And then in 2:24, it very clearly states, this explains why a man leaves his mother and father and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. And then in chapter 5, verse 2, it says, he created them male and female, and he blessed them and called them human. So Jesus here is taking them back deliberately to the original plan. He doesn't want to really focus on divorce so much at the moment. And he's making it clear that God ordained marriage to be between a man and a woman. And there's meant to be a unity, a working partnership, to be one flesh. Amen? Amen. One flesh. Amen. It's the men are really meant to go, amen. One flesh. These days, mobile phones get in the way. Anyway, to be one flesh, male and female. And yes, I will stick with man and a woman. That's it. Don't know if you saw the news this morning or this week. There's a big issue again in the Anglican community with the LGBT and all of that going on at the moment. You'll hear it all this week on the news because the General Synod are meeting together to discuss the issue again. But just a scriptural understanding here for me is between a man and a woman. But it's that actually they become one flesh. They're no longer individuals. You are no longer your own person when you become married. Good. You have somebody else you have to think about in the marriage. Amen. Therefore, you can't be selfish. Men, amen. But actually, it's true. I make a joke of it, but it's absolutely true. We humans are a selfish bunch. Let's be honest, aren't we? It's all about me. Thank you, Jonathan. Well done. It's all about me. Me, 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 me. And that reflects actually into church, funny enough. Oh, do you know, I wake up this morning. So this is not condemnation. Hear me carefully. But how much do you think about being at church on a Sunday? Oh, they're not going to miss me. Oh, thank you, Andy. Oh, yes, they are. He's got his saint badge on. He's doing well. Oh, yes, they are. Because actually, your gifting, the way that God has built you, your uniqueness is part of the body. Now, please don't hear me. Hear me carefully. This is not, you must be at church every day, every Sunday. All right? That's not what I'm saying. We all have lives and everything else. Absolutely. We all have to, some of us have to work as well on the Sunday. But just that concept of I won't be missed, that's my excuse for not being at church on Sunday. Actually, yes, you will be. That makes you feel better about yourself and you should be at church. Be at church. If you think I'm talking to you right now, no, I'm not. I'm just came to me. So, marriage means we shouldn't be selfish. Do you know, I'm really going to hate this later on this afternoon. This is going to so be used against me. And so then what Jesus is trying to say, I just want to sleep, love. Don't be so selfish. You said so. You preached at a church. Right. Anyway. Where are we? Yeah, selfish. You become one. So therefore then what happens is you're no longer selfish. Therefore then, the way that the marriage works is, according to Genesis here, and you see it especially in Ephesians chapter 5, wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for it. Therefore, husbands, you need to do the same. Your wives will submit to you because you love them the way that Christ loved you and loves the church. Okay?
Amen.
Good. Let's get that right, men. Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, redeemed it so far. I'm still getting myself further into trouble for this afternoon. And so therefore we see that it is meant to be non-selfishness. So let's get back to Deuteronomy 24 and this whole concept of if he finds anything wrong in her. What was this about? Well, there was a valid reason that a man could give a certificate of divorce was because he found something in her that did not please him. Well, the Hebrew sense in that word there is he found something scandalous in her. Okay? You're really intensely listening now, aren't you? Can't you? Okay, let's look at two possible interpretations on that from two Pharisaic schools. Rabbi Shamia and his followers thought the word meant unchaste or adulterous. So that's the only thing that he was able to find within this wrong in these women that basically she went off and had a long-term affair. But Rabbi Hillier and his followers thought the meaning was very much wider, almost postmodernistic in a minute, and would allow divorce by the husband for simple reasons as the wife accidentally serving him food that had been slightly burnt. Or if she'd spoken too loudly, that he feels the neighbours could have heard the conversation. There's no fear in our household of that. We both talk too loudly in the neighbours. So you can see by looking at the Bible, there were two schools of interpretation. So you can understand, by the time we get to sort of around in Jesus' time, etc., well, it depends on which school of thought you wanted to follow. Yeah? If you didn't hear Carol, Carol said, I bet they chose the second one. Men. You're absolutely right, Carol. Men, really. So the point is, though, you sit there and you laugh, but actually that's how we fall into the trap society. You see these celebrity marriages and divorces, and we don't know the full story, truly, but it's interesting how there's no sense of working through issues. Oh, I've got bored. Let's just move on to the next one. Yeah? And I bet they would like it much easier these days. I'll just write a certificate of divorce. Goodbye. But so you've got this here in Deuteronomy. So the problem is, by the time you've got to Jesus, there is actually too much flimsy reason as to why a man's divorcing his wife. So this is why Jesus flips to not focusing on Deuteronomy, but going actually more, because that's literally like, what, four verses? Yeah, in the whole of the book of the Torah. And he's saying, but hang on a minute, look at the original plan. And then if you look at the rest, it talks about how a man and a woman should be together. It's God ordained. And the whole thing of Deuteronomy was damage limitation. So Jesus is clearly picking up here that actually God takes marriage actually very seriously and the continuation of marriage seriously. But there is some justification for divorce. Jesus then talks about in Matthew 19, which would reflect the first rabbinic understanding of reasons that you can get divorced. I'm just going to turn to it for you. See, in Matthew 19. It's the same conversation effectively being written in Matthew. And Jesus replies, Moses permitted divorce only as a concession to your hard hearts. But it was not what God had originally intended. And I tell you this, whoever divorces his wife and marries someone else commits adultery, unless his wife has been unfaithful. Now, please bear in mind, this is all talking around Deuteronomy 24, and the question has been instigated about, can a man divorce his wife? This is not going the other way for a minute. And here, within Matthew, what we have is Jesus saying, but if there's adultery that's occurred, yes, a man has a right to divorce. He's picked up the rabbi Shemir's teaching and decided around an unchaste wife, yes, there is justification. But it's not for one-offs. You know, we all make mistakes. And it's not saying it's one-offs. It's about being repentant. It's about an ongoing situation, I would humbly suggest. But then that's been used as good reasons in teaching today to say that is the only reason you can get divorced. As I said to you, remember, broad brushstroke teaching here, okay? But I want to go back to that original reason for why you are married. It is that you are one flesh. You are no longer selfish. Now, there is no justification. Sorry, let's rephrase that. The breaking of the marital breakup by having an adulterous affair is being selfish, yes? Would you agree with that? Okay, I know this could be painful for some people, please bear that in mind. But there is selfishness, because the person having the affair, be it male or female, are being selfish. Oh, it can be justified, I am sure. Justified. But they're being selfish. So for me, there is within, beyond this context, one flesh not being selfish. Let's take something else. Domestic violence. An ongoing domestic violence, surely, is the person perpetrating, being the domestic violencer, the perpetrator, is being selfish. So that's why I said this broad brush stroking. And it's not just domestic violence, there's emotional abuse. I could go on forever. But the point is, actually, we are called in marriage, if you're married, you are called in your marriage to not be self-centered. So just to take that in that context, because some people think it's just about being adulterous, that's the only reason that you can ever break up. Well, I think I would take it beyond, it's within selfishness. Also, you've got to be careful what you mean by selfish. Because a good example was given to me this week, was the fact that, well, say a wife demands that she's only going to cook what she wants to cook for the family, yeah? And taking in no account that maybe what the husband might want, is she being selfish? Well, yes and no. The husband can get off his backside and go and learn how to cook what he wants, yeah? Amen. Thought I might get some brownie points. I cooked twice this week. That's a miracle in this family. But I don't complain about the cooking I get. So what I'm saying is be very careful what we consider to be self-centered and selfish. It is an ongoing, hard heart, not noticing what you are doing that is wrong. As much as you're told by your spouse, or you're told by others within your community makeup. God's original plan for marriage was to be long-lasting. And this concept of let no one split up whom God has put together, well, here it was the man doing the splitting up. And so then you have this later teaching when the disciples are bringing it up again. Why have they brought it up again? Because they've lived with this whole concept that it's really easy to divorce your wife. It's their societal norm. And Jesus has just gone and flipped on head. They go, well, hang on a minute. Well, no. It's in the Torah. It's in the book of the law. It's okay. And Jesus has gone, no, actually, that was given to you because Moses knew your heart was hard. Your hard heart was hard. My speech is terrible. So can I ask the question again? And Jesus really wants to emphasize that whoever divorces his wife and marries someone else has actually committed adultery. And what he's talking about is going back to the original reason why have you divorced. If it's for a flimsy reason, then you're committing adultery. Okay? Flimsy reason. Okay? So we need to make that into account. Now, if you're somebody here who has, in the past, been married and got divorced and you're starting to think, did I do wrong? I want to take you to Mark chapter 3, verse 28. I tell you the truth, all sin and blasphemy can be forgiven. Okay? I find that some people, after some teaching, feel very condemned. And I don't want you to feel like that at all. I want you to register that verse 28, that actually all sin can be forgiven. There is no sense that it's not forgiven, ever. God's already forgiven it. Move on. Don't worry about it. But this is what we have to unpack. We can't avoid difficult teaching in the Bible. We have to go through it. So, I'm going to be in trouble this afternoon. Let's move on to 13 to 16. One day, some parents brought their children to Jesus so they could touch and bless them. But the disciples scolded the parents for bothering him. When Jesus saw what had happened, he was angry with his disciples, and he said to them, Don't let the children come to me. Let the children come to me. Don't stop them. For the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children. I tell you the truth. Anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. Then he took the children in his arms and placed his hands on their heads and blessed them. Okay, first and foremost, if we do remember, which I didn't mention earlier, that women were less in society. So they were one step down, effectively in the eyes of society. But actually, by Jesus quoting Genesis 1, he's saying, no, actually, you're equal. And then here we come to the children. And you think the women are less down? Children don't exist. They're the untouchables. They just don't exist in Jewish eyes until they have officially seen as become as adults. They don't exist. So when these parents, which is really odd that they're bringing up Jesus to this rabbi, please bless our children, disciples on one level are only doing what they assume is the right thing. No, don't bother the teacher. He's far too important for them. The idea of Jesus being too important for people, eh? Isn't that interesting? But Jesus is breaking society norms. He's saying, no, let the children come. And the fact he took them in his arms, I mean, that's real acknowledgement. You know, when we talk about, oh, God's got you in his arms, and we go, yeah. Well, here you go. God does, picks up in the arms. And he blesses them. I mean, this was just beyond. And what Jesus is saying, actually, nobody is too far, high and mighty to deal with little ones. And that means for us, I think, that we are not too far, high and mighty to bless those around us who society sees as the lesser ones. Those who are low in status in society. And I want us to name them. Who does society see as low in status?
Black people.
Sorry? People without jobs? Drunks? Refugees? Oh, I just shout them out one at a time.
Homeless?
Destitute?
Elderly?
Ex-offenders? Psychologically ill people. So those with mental health issues, yeah, okay. Or what's perceived as mental health issues, yeah. Anybody else? Yep, drunks, alcoholics, drug addicts. Miriam's going for one. Women don't, yeah, you're right, for the same job, women don't get paid the same amount as men. That is generally on the whole.
Sometimes they get paid more.
Okay.
They're not merited.
People will know the Lord Jesus by how much you love each other. Yeah. I just thought I'd leave that one. Thank you. Talk about opener. Next time I won't let you shout it out. I'll keep control with the microphone. Can of worms, yeah, and then some. But you're right. I mean, there is disequality in church, and within society. And we could go on forever unpacking those who are seen as the less in society. It wasn't a million years ago, it was single mums. Yeah? And in some parts, it still is. Notice the single dads get ignored. Just thought I'd throw that out there. Let's balance the sexism. But we are not too high and mighty to be people who bless them. Amen? If Jesus says, I will see those who society ignores, we should do the same. I just want to leave it at that for that one. I don't want us to bang on about that too much. So, verse 17 to 31. Kevin, could I ask you to come and read that for me, please? Sorry, I want to save my voice a little bit. Would you mind reading it from there? Is that okay? To 31, so flip over here. Thanks.
As Jesus was starting out on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked. "Only God is truly good. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder, you must not commit adultery, you must not steal, you must not testify falsely, you must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and mother." "Teacher," the man replied, "I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young." Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. "There is still one thing you haven't done," he told him. "Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven." This amazed them, but Jesus said again, "Dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom of heaven. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven." The disciples were astounded. "Then who in the world can be saved?" they asked. Jesus looked at them intently and said, "Humanly speaking, it is impossible, but not with God. Everything is possible with God." Then Peter began to speak up. "We have given up everything to follow you," he said. "Yes," Jesus replied, "and I assure you that everyone who's given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or property for my sake and for the good news will receive now in return 100 times as many houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and property, and along with them persecution. And in the world to come, that person will have eternal life. But many who are the greatest now will be least important then. And those who seem least important now will be the greatest then."
Thank you, Kevin, very much indeed. Also, it gives you a different voice to listen to this morning rather than mine. Okay, I'm going to be honest. Bola did such a wonderful, good job of this passage from Matthew that I really don't want to linger on too long. But there is an area I do want to linger on it in particular. But go to the website. It's there. We know it's the young rich man thinking he's sticking to everything, but hanging on to the security of his wealth. He wants to know what he must do to inherit the kingdom of God. Well, the doing is actually just putting your faith in Jesus and following him and then having a relationship with him. Everything else follows after that. But we have this thing at the end, which gets me with Peter. We've given up everything to follow you, he says. Yes, Jesus replies, I assure you that everyone who's given up house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or property for my sake and for the good news will receive now and return 100 times as many houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children and property. I'm just going to leave it at that for a minute. So, there's a new thing that we're going to be teaching now in Greenford Baptist Church. What's going to happen? If you can dig into your wallets, pull out a tenner, and I will unpack for you, if you give me £10 now, that the Lord is going to bless you 100-fold. Dive in then. Let's go. And if you want healing, give me £100 and the Lord will bless you with healing. Amen. No, rubbish, thank you. First and foremost, I do want to unpack the fact that actually all three of those sections we've gone through so far in Mark 10 is actually about discipleship. It is actually about being a disciple of God, of Jesus. In Mark, that whole thing about divorce and remarriage, etc., is actually, well, hang on a minute. If that's your focus, you're missing the focus of God. And you should do in your discipleship. If you want to understand what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, then you've got to not think yourself any higher than anybody else. You can bless the low of society. And here's the same thing. As a disciple, we are to sacrifice things. And just recognize we are going to get it back 100-fold. By the way, not now, but after death. It's about hope. And that's what these passages are about. It's about discipleship. This is why you've got this ending three passages. But many who are the greatest now will be the least important then. And those who seem the least important now will be the greatest then. Then being in the kingdom of heaven afterwards it all. Yes? Okay. So this whole passage is about giving up. It's not about health, wealth and prosperity teaching. Because if that was true, my Ferrari would be sitting outside. And I want us to pick that up. But there's a bit that gets missed when these health and wealth and prosperity teaching goes on. Do you know the bit that's missed? It's this lovely promise that Jesus, I don't know if you can notice it in verse 30, you receive now in a turn 100 times as many houses. Amen? Brothers, amen? Sisters, amen? Mothers, amen? Children and property, amen? I get my one on the coast. Along with persecution. And that's the bit, thank you. Somebody's getting it. Along with persecution. Along with persecution!
Amen.
That's the point we miss, especially in the West. We like the whole idea that we're going to float 2 foot off the ground like Jesus did. Oh, no, he didn't. That nothing's going to touch us like it didn't touch Jesus. No, he did die on the cross, didn't he? He did get whipped. Yes? But we live in the Western society forgetting that part of our Christian walk is about sacrifice. It is about suffering. But Jesus doesn't focus on that entirely. He talks about what you're going to get in the future. Look at this big picture, folks. It's worth 80 to 90 years on this planet for what you're going to get for all eternity. Look, I'm going to suffer this afternoon for my teaching earlier, all right? About not being selfish. So come with me on this one, all right? But I want us to focus on the fact that we have to recognize that when we give our lives to Christ, we are giving up a lot. But what we get in return is beyond imagination. But we will get persecuted. We will have trouble in our workplaces for standing up for Jesus. If you're in trouble in your workplace because you're being dead lazy, that's your problem. Don't sit in there going, I'm suffering for Jesus, because you ain't. All right? You're suffering because you're dead lazy. And sometimes we do have to try and split up the difference. When things come our way and we think, oh, I'm suffering because of Jesus. Actually, sometimes you're not. You're suffering because you've made mistakes. Whether you like it or not, you've made mistakes. And what you're now getting is the result of your choices that you made that were wrong choices. And you knew they were wrong choices when you made them. I said this teaching wasn't going to be all cheerful. But that's the point, you see? But actually, we suffer persecution for knowing Jesus. When that happens, it's when we stand for what is truth and what is right. So like saying marriage is between a man and a woman, end of story. In our postmodern, we don't like doing that because it might mean we might be persecuted. Well, hard tees, folks. That comes of standing for Jesus. We've got to stand for something at some point. Haven't we? I'm sick to death of giving away ground, and I mean we, the church, not just GBC, I mean the church, because we don't want to be persecuted. Because we don't want to be seen we don't want to be seen as intolerant. Well, welcome to Judgment Day, because there will be an intolerance. Did you choose Jesus or didn't you? There is an intolerance. It's part of God's love and mercy that there is justice. So persecution comes and part and parcel of our walk with Christ. Now, when Mark is writing this at this point and picking up this teaching here, the church here were truly being persecuted. You know, when you're being stuck on poles and burnt alive. I think that's called being persecuted for being a Christian, yes? We over here don't get persecuted. We get laughed at. That's not what I call persecution. So in this fantastic unpacking this morning, and I'm not praising myself up, trust me. What I'm saying is I want you to pick up three things. First and foremost, if we go back to the original reason here of divorce and remarriage and what that looks like, it can't be for flimsy reasons. We are called to bless those who are low in our society. And we are called to be persecuted. We are called to stand for Jesus. We are called to make real sacrifices. We are called to tell people that unless you come to follow Jesus, you're going to not have eternal life. You are going to hell. Whatever version you think that looks like, either way, it's eternal separation from God. We are called to do that. We are called to stand and make those claims. Not go, well, yeah, maybe that route into heaven. Yeah, maybe if you follow that religion, God might be a little bit tolerant. We are called to make that stand, my brothers and sisters. I'll give you a couple of minutes to talk to God. Let's do that now. Lord, Heavenly Father, being recognized, actually, we use that word, Lord, sometimes in a passing, fleeting moment, but actually, you are Lord. Yours is the overall story. And Lord, I want to pray for each of us this morning as we have looked at your word. For some of us this morning, it's going to have been hard teaching. But you are Lord. Lord, in some of that, you would have spoken to some of us about sacrifice and persecution and to stop protecting ourselves. But you are Lord. So, Lord, I ask that for each of us, we recognize your lordship in our lives. We're guided by you in our choices on a daily basis. And we run this life recognizing the future glory, the future possessions, for want of a better phrasing, Lord, that we are going to be crowned with for following you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.